I end almost all of my speeches by telling my father's story, and not because I promised him that I would, but because I think it leads to more valuable lessons than most anything else I had said during the talk. I'd like to tell you his story just to you here. The year was 1939, and the town was Sierpce, Poland. My father was living with his family in a bucolic town, though we locked their doors. And then one day there was a knock on the door, and it was two Nazis in black boots. And unlike in the movies, they didn't yell. One was silent, and the other said, "You will be out of your house with only what you can carry on your back by noon tomorrow, or else." And the next day there weren't two Nazis. There were 12. And they were no longer silent. They went into all the Jewish homes and said, "Raus!" Arrested all of the Jews out of their homes, and they took my father and put him in one truck and put his father and mother in another truck, and he never saw them again. He and 11 men escaped from a work camp and lived in the Black Forest for a year, thanks to the good Christians who took care of him. And then he was, at the end of the war, he was put on a cargo boat and dropped in the Bronx, without a penny to his name, no English, no money, no education, no nothing other than a $50 check that he got from Hayas, a nonprofit organization, and that was it. What did he do? No job was beneath him. He ended up sewing shirts in a factory in Harlem. And what did he do at night? Did he say, "I'm a Holocaust survivor, I'm exhausted, I'm going to go and party down"? No, he went to Roosevelt High School, night school, to learn English, because he knew unless he spoke good English, he would never get anywhere. And what did he do on Saturdays? Did he watch Saturday sports? No, he went to the owner of the factory where he had sewn the shirts and said, "Can I buy the shirts I sewed for you during the week and sell them out of a cardboard box on the streets?" And he bought them for a buck and sold them for a buck and a half. What did he do with the money? Did he spend it? Did he say, "Now it's Saturday night, it's time to party down"? No. He saved up the first and last month's rent on the only place, only storefront he could afford. It was 105 Moore Street in Brooklyn. You can Google it now, and it's still one of the worst neighborhoods in New York. Because, you see, he had met my mom in that night school, Roosevelt Night School, in the Bronx, and we lived in a tenement under the wreck, half a block away from the elevated train that roared 24/7 in a fourth floor horrible walkout. You can look that up too, 1135 Evergreen Avenue in the Bronx. And then, so he saved the money for that store. Well, the store was not really quite a store, not much of a store at all. Not only was it in a terrible neighborhood, on one side there was a Puerto Rican deli that specialized in chicharrones, deep fried pork intestines, so the smell of that merged with the smell from the store on the other side, which was a live chicken market, and the stale blood, and the chicharrones smell was quite the aroma for a clothing store. And the store was so small that he had to store most of the merchandise out on folding tables. And this was a persistent guy. He didn't drive, he couldn't afford a car. He took a bus and two trains, often one or two trains, to get to his store, and then rain or shine, in the winter, he would walk the six blocks from that train station to his store. And his persistence was particularly tested because while nobody could have been a more honorable owner, they sold Ray-Ban. Ray-Ban, before it was a quote, designer label, was a plain old, just an eyeglass company, a sunglass company. He bought those things for a buck on the Lower East Side, and he sold them for a buck and a half. By the way, you don't deal with wholesalers on the internet back then. He would drive on Sundays, the one day he was closed. He would drive. He would take the train with me and my mom and my sister to the Lower East Side to buy merchandise for the store. And he and all of us would be carrying boxes. We'd go to these, quote, wholesale places on the Lower East Side, which are hardly wholesale. But that's where he got his stuff, and we would take it back. And he would take those on the train with him to the store. And if that isn't enough, because today's word is the community, like to have people only of their ethnic background or two to own their stores. They tried to burn him out three times. Three times he was called in the middle of the night by the police to say that there was arson in his store. But he stayed, partly because he couldn't afford anything else. One day, not one day, before we get to the one day part, I was, those tables that were out there, they, like I said, all the merchandise was there, including those sunglasses and shirts and whatever. And as I said, it was a very tough neighborhood, and the kids would come by, and they would steal whole boxes of shirts. You know, that were terrible for him, but he couldn't afford a security guard. So as soon as I got old enough to be, quote, the security guard, it was me on Saturdays, which was the busiest the day when the kids were out of school. And one day, and this was the most memorable moment of my life, business was slow, and I remember standing in front of the store with my dad. There was a parking meter in front of the store. I remember having one elbow on one side of the parking meter, and my dad, like a mirror image, had his elbow on the other. And I said, something like this popped idea popped into my head. I said, "Daddy, how come you so rarely talk about the Holocaust?" And he stiffened, which was something he rarely did. And he said, "Martin, the Nazis took 5 years from my life. I won't give them 1 minute more." He said, "Martin, never look back. Always take the next step forward." And I have had the privilege of having been a career and personal coach to some of the most successful people on the planet, as well as to some real strugglers. And one of the key differentiating features is that my successful ones are far more likely to follow my father's advice. Never look back. Always take the next step forward. And that's the lesson of my father's that I like to share with people, and I wanted to share with you. Thank you for watching. I'm Marty Nemko.